Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. These are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is with reference to a press statement that was released on February 26, 2021 by the Secretary of State of United States, Antony J. Blinken. The press statement was titled as Accountability for the Murder of Jamal Khashoggi. In the analysis of this op-ed article, we'll see who is Jamal Khashoggi and what were his relationship with the US government, the Saudi Arabian government, and what happened in October 2018. And we'll see what were the actions that have been initiated in connection with the disappearance or murder of Jamal Khashoggi. And we'll see some reasons why US could not take a hard stand on Saudi Arabia despite of being called as the superpower of the world. And we'll also have a brief background on Saudi-US relations as well. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this op-ed article is highlighted here for your reference. Majorly, the article opines that the CIA report on Jamal Khashoggi is not likely to cause a major reversal in the relationship of US and Saudi Arabia. Rather, it may cause only a short-term recalibration. So now let's go to the background of all these issues. See, Jamal Khashoggi was an important Saudi Arabian journalist who covered major stories for various Saudi news organizations. For many years, he was close to Saudi royal family and he has also served as an advisor to the Saudi government. In the year 2017, he fell out of the favor from some members of royal family and went for a self-imposed exile and settled in the United States. And from then on, he started writing a monthly column in the Washington Post wherein he criticized the policies of Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, who's called as the de facto ruler of Saudi Arabia. And as per reports, it is said that in the month of October 2018, Khashoggi visited the Saudi consulate in Istanbul in Turkey for obtaining a statement of divorce, but he never returned again. There was a disappearance, and finally, the US government, through intelligence reports, concluded that he was murdered. It was seen from the perspective of US population as a writer of Washington Post was murdered in Turkey through an operation that was carried out by Saudi in a foreign land, that is in Turkey. Therefore, it was a matter of serious concern for United States as Jamal was a lawful permanent resident of the United States, and it also goes against the notion that individuals should be able to exercise their human rights and fundamental freedoms without fear of government retribution, retaliation, punishment or harm. And when the incident occurred in 2018, at the time we know that Mr. Donald was the president of the United States, it was reported that he failed to carry out an effective measure against the murder of Jamal Khashoggi. And it is only now, that is during the Biden-Harris administration, a previously classified report or a secret report on this issue has been submitted to the Congress in declassified form. That is, it is now available for public. In reference to this, the US government has announced measures to reinforce world's condemnation of these sort of crimes and to push back governments that reach beyond their borders to threaten and attack journalists and perceived dissidents for exercising their fundamental freedoms. So you can relate here, Saudi carried out the attack on Jamal Khashoggi in a foreign land, that is in Turkey. And the US president has also set up a new visa restriction policy and he has named this policy as the Khashoggi ban. What is this ban? This ban is all about allowing the US government to impose visa restrictions on certain individuals who are found to be engaged in serious extraterritorial counter-dissident activities, primarily acting on behalf of a foreign government. It could be their own government or on behalf of a foreign government. Whoever officials from that government are involved in extraterritorial counter-dissident activities, they will be restricted to visit United States by the US State Department. And as per a statement by US officials, the report by Central Intelligence Agency has concluded the involvement of Mohammed bin Salman in this murder. With this information, let us come to the news article. Now, how is it concluded that Mohammed bin Salman has got a role in this murder? See, this is based on evidence that persons responsible for the murder were actually members of the security of Crown Prince. And they were also reported to be his close advisors. So this shows that it may not be possible for such a murder to happen without the knowledge of Mohammed bin Salman or without the approval of him. It argues that an operation of this nature could not have been conducted without his approval. The US Congress had been demanding for more than a year that this report should be declassified. However, Mr. Donald, who was the former president, he refused to do so because of the relationship with Mohammed bin Salman and him and his son-in-law and his senior advisor. This is in relation with Mr. Trump's interest in selling massive amounts of oil to the petrostate called as Saudi Arabia. See, when we say petrostate, it is a nation whose economy is heavily dependent on the extraction and export of oil. The article opines that the release of this report is, however, not expected to bring a major reversal or reevaluation in the relationship between USA and Saudi Arabia, except it calls for a short-term recalibration in US approach towards Saudi. So what is the US expecting by the release of the press statement and the report? See, the press statement in the end clearly states that while the United States remains invested in its relationship with Saudi Arabia, President Biden has made clear that the partnership must reflect US values. And what do they refer here as US values? They are saying that it is US value that it will not carry out any extraterritorial threat or assault against activists, dissidents or journalists. If such actions are performed by foreign countries, they will not be tolerated by the United States. And the report and the statement, however, could be seen as public relations exercise that was undertaken to pacify the congressional anger and the anger among the human rights constituency. How we are saying that there could not be a major reversal in the relationship? See, this is because sanctions were imposed or the restrictions were imposed on few Saudi authorities, but not on Mohammed bin Salman, as he was not subjected to any penalties. And prior to the day of release of the report, there was conversation between the leaders of two countries, and the Saudi monarch was assured of US support for his country's security against Iran-aligned groups. So this act of Biden shows that he is trying to balance between the domestic anger in United States related to the death of the journalist, at the same time trying to preserve America's long-standing strategic and economic relationship with Saudi regime. Now let us see some reasons why US does not want to act hard on Saudi Arabia despite being called the superpower. See, first point is that the strategical importance of Saudi Arabia for United States. See, Saudi Arabia is the principal regional partner for US in its efforts containing the influence of Iran in West Asia. And the strategic value of Saudi gained more importance with the recent sequential normalization of relations of Israel with some of the Arab countries that are allied to Saudi Arabia. This is because for Saudi's allies there, for them to come to an understanding with Israel is heavily dependent on Saudi's approval. Now, what may US get because of normalization of Israel's relations with some of the Arab countries? See, it will relieve the pressure from United States so as to address the Palestinian issue. And know that Saudi Arabia is the swing producer of oil for the health of global economy. And this proves to be a predominant reason for the balance of relations, because the prosperity of US lies on the global economy to the larger extent. When we say swing producer, it refers to a supplier, in this case Saudi, the oil supplier, which has a large amount of spare capacity, so much that it can influence market prices by moderating their output level up or down at their own will. Then the US also cannot react or alienate Saudi Arabia beyond a certain point, because we know that US in this current regime has expressed its intent to rejoin the Iran in the nuclear deal. But reports say that Saudi has opposed this move, and this is because the deal will give some relief to Iran from the existing sanctions, which Saudi Arabia does not like. If relationship becomes sore, then there are chances for Saudi to go on public on this issue along with Israel, which also considers Iran to be its enemy. Both Saudi and Israel are not happy with relieving Iran from existing sanctions. And it is expected that once this intense reaction towards Khashoggi's report subsides, we can expect both the countries to be getting back to their normal functioning. So in this light, let us have a brief background on Saudi-United States relations. See, Saudi was recognized by United States in the year 1931. Since then, the US and Saudi have established full diplomatic relations. And Saudi's strategic location plays a very important role in the long-standing bilateral relationship between both the countries. And they also have got a long-standing security relationship. This is mainly in the context of containing Iran. And know that Saudi Arabia is United States' largest foreign military sales customer. If you see US has two important defense sales program. One is foreign military sales program, and the other is direct commercial sales. When you take foreign military sales, the US government carries out sales of defense equipment to foreign allies and partners. There will be some concession in this arrangement. So Saudi Arabia is part of this arrangement. And also the US and Saudi enjoy a strong economic partnership. See, US is Saudi Arabia's second largest trade partner. And Saudi Arabia is one of United States' largest trading partners in the Middle East. In addition to this, Saudi Arabia is the third leading source of imported oil for the United States. And they have also have trade investment framework agreement as well. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article, which is with reference to accountability in relation to murder of Jamal Khashoggi, a lawful permanent resident of United States and a columnist or a writer at the Washington Post. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is an explanatory article about ethanol blended petrol. The article mentions that there were reports of water in this petrol surface that was sold in some of the parts of Tamil Nadu. So let us see about ethanol, uses of ethanol, then we'll see ethanol blended petrol, and we'll see some government initiatives in relation to ethanol blended petrol. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. First, let us see what is ethanol. See, ethanol is known as ethyl alcohol. It is a clear, colorless liquid that has a non-disturbing or agreeable odor. It is an alcohol fuel that provides high quality, high octane for exceptional engine performance and reduced emissions. See, here we said high octane. See, it denotes octane ratings. Octane ratings are measure of fuel stability. These ratings are based on the pressure at which a fuel will spontaneously combust, that is, a fuel will auto ignite in a testing engine. So higher the octane number, the more stable is the fuel. See, ethanol has 113 octane rating. So ethanol is the highest performance fuel on the market and keeps today's high compression engines to run smoothly. See, ethanol is made from various plant materials, which are collectively known as biomass. So it's a type of biofuel, and this represents the first generation of biofuel technology. Today, nearly all ethanol produced in the world is derived from starch-based and sugar-based feedstocks. But since ancient times, ethanol is being made by fermentation of sugars. And today, all the beverage ethanol and more than half of industrial ethanol is still made by this process only. Additionally, sugarcane, sweet sorghum and sugar beet, these are also used internationally for the production of ethanol because they are sugar containing feedstock. Apart from this, maize, wheat and other cereals containing starch that can be easily converted to sugar, and they are used in ethanol production. Now coming to India, ethanol is primarily produced using sugarcane molasses. See, molasses is a byproduct of sugarcane. This is an example of first generation biofuel. Now coming to the uses of ethanol, see, it is used to power fuel cells and also used to produce biodiesel. Now our focus is on ethanol's use as fuel. It is mainly because of its possible environmental advantages and long-term economic advantages over fossil fuels. See, as a fuel, ethanol is either used alone or sometimes in combination with other fuels. Mainly, ethanol can be combined with petrol in any concentration. See, anhydrous ethanol, which is ethanol without water, can be blended with petrol in varying quantities. This is called as ethanol blended petrol. Here, ethanol is used as a blending agent with petrol. Why do we do so? We do so to increase octane, to cut down carbon monoxide and other smog-causing emissions so as to reduce air pollution. Then we do so to reduce the consumption of petroleum fuels. Next, ethanol is increasingly used as an oxygenate additive for standard petrol. This is mainly used as a replacement for methyl tert-butyl ether. See, here the term oxygenates refer to oxygen-containing compounds that are used as fuel components or additives. These fuel additives are used to improve combustion. So these additives change the combustion characteristics, which influences the toxic effects of resulting emissions. In this regard, we should know that methyl tert-butyl ether is chemically responsible for considerable groundwater contamination and soil contamination. So in its place, now ethanol is being widely used. Now with respect to the percentage of ethanol blending with petrol, it varies from country to country according to the concerned government's energy policies. Now coming to India, Indian government has been promoting the use of ethanol as a blend stock with main automotive fuel like petrol under its program called as the Ethanol Blended Petrol Program. This program is in line with the National Policy on Biofuels 2018. See, under this program, government has 10% blending target for mixing ethanol with petrol by the year 2022 and has 20% blending target, which is to be achieved by the year 2030. See, initially in the year 2006, the Union Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas directed the oil marketing companies to sell 5% ethanol blended petrol in few notified states or union territories. But now, particularly with effect from April 2019, this program has been extended to whole of India except union territories of Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep. And now oil marketing companies sell petrol blended with ethanol up to 10%. Now, why is ethanol environment friendly? See, this is because ethanol molecule contains oxygen. This oxygen allows the engine to more completely combust the fuel. What happens when there is complete combustion of fuel? This results in very less or fewer or no emissions. Also note that the CO2 released by a vehicle when ethanol is burned is offset by CO2 captured when the feedstock crops are grown to produce ethanol. This feature of ethanol as fuel differs from gasoline and diesel because gasoline and diesel, they are refined from petroleum extracted from the earth. So no emissions are offset when these petroleum products are burned. And since ethanol is produced from plants which harness the power of the sun, ethanol is also considered as a renewable fuel. See, feedstock usually can easily be grown through sunlight. So these points were used to bring it under the classification of renewable fuel. Additionally, ethanol blended fuel, it keeps the fuel system clean for optimal performance because it does not leave any gummy deposits. You see, gummy deposits are formed when fuel slowly reacts with the oxygen in the air at the ambient temperatures. These deposits stick to the metal surfaces along the vehicle fuel system from tank to combustion chamber. And accumulation of these deposits or products can cause wear and tear to the engine and can have adverse effects on engine efficiency, engine performance, emission and durability. This issue is solved by ethanol blended fuels. So these are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In the analysis we saw about ethanol, uses of ethanol, what do we mean by ethanol blended petrol, what are the various advantages of ethanol blended petrol, and we also saw why is ethanol environment friendly. We also did see about few government initiatives in this regard. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This article is with reference to the IT Rules 2021, that is the IT Rules Guidelines for Intermediaries and Digital Media Ethics Code 2021, which was recently released by the government. The rules are broadly concerned with social media platforms, digital news and OTT platforms. In the last week, we have discussed the rules pertaining to OTTs and social media platforms in detail. In today's discussion, we will briefly discuss the issues with the new set of rules as outlined by the author. The new rules superseded the extant rules issued under Section 79 of IT Act. The extant rules were issued in 2011. The previous rules specified due diligence obligations that internet mediaries had to follow. This is to qualify for limited immunity from legal liability with respect to user content. This provision is also called a safe harbor provision. See Section 79 of IT Act 2000, it grants safe harbor protection to intermediaries for any kind of third party content. It provides conditional immunity to the intermediary under the due diligence doctrine, irrespective of the nature of the content. What does this mean? See, Facebook is not liable for the data posted by some user on its platform. But this does not imply that absolute immunity is provided to Facebook or other intermediaries. This is because these intermediaries are mandated to remove any content under the order of the government or the order of court of law, if that order requires any intermediary to remove information within a stipulated time frame. If the intermediary fails to do so within a stipulated period, protection under the safe harbor may be taken immediately, and Facebook or other such intermediaries can be held liable for the content that is available or posted on its platform. Now let's come to the concerns with reference to the new rules. See, firstly, author states that government has increased censorship of internet content and it is mandating compliance from the intermediaries with the demands of the government regarding user data collection and policing of online services in India. The problem here is all this happened without any open or public discussion of the regulatory powers or without any parliamentary study or parliamentary scrutiny. And the author notes that these rules are unlawful even in the context of IT Act also. There is a question that whether such rules can be issued under IT Act itself. Then the government has ruled that internet intermediaries, so as to claim qualified legal immunity, they must abide the new rules. Here, when we say internet intermediaries, it includes telecom providers, search engines, internet platforms that host user-generated content. Then it also includes cloud providers. Here we should understand that the ability to issue rules under a statute or law, that is, the ability to frame a subordinate legislation, is a limited constrained power. When the union government issues subordinate rules, it is limited to the substantive provisions that are laid out by the parliament in the principal legislation or the original act that is passed by parliament. Here, the executive branch is subordinate to what parliament has permitted it, and the executive cannot use its rulemaking power to seek to issue primary legislation by itself. Because lawmaking is the power of parliament and not the executive. And the executive should not issue primary legislation in the name of rules. Here, author notes that the government has precisely went beyond the limit what it could do under a subordinate legislation. How, instead of specifying the basic due diligence requirements that intermediaries had to perform to be eligible for claiming safe harbor provision, the executive branch, that is the government, has created new rules that apply only to significant social media intermediaries. The author is saying this term is not present in the original IT Act 2000. The new rules make a distinction between social media intermediaries and significant social media intermediaries. This is done to encourage innovations and to enable growth of new social media intermediaries. See, smaller platforms should not be subjected to significant compliance requirement. So this was the agenda behind this term, significant social media intermediaries. Now the distinction is based on the number of users on the social media platform. Significant social media intermediaries are mandated to follow certain additional due diligence. The author is saying that when there is no provision in original act talking about significant social media intermediaries, it is not lawful for the government to make distinction between social media intermediaries, that too through a subordinate legislation. As we said already, subordinate legislation refers to legislation made by an authority that is subordinate to the legislature, in this case parliament. So the powers of the executive in this relation are limited. In addition, new rules mandate for retention of user data by these intermediaries so that government agencies, when request, must be provided. And this also mandates to enable the tracing of original creator of the message. But this is not possible for end-to-end encrypted messaging services without introducing some malwares in their systems. Author says that the sections in the IT Act, which were cited by the government in relation to these provisions in the new rules of 2021, do not give such power to the government. So, there is a conclusion that government has crossed the boundaries that is set by the parliament in the IT Act through these new rules. Now, there is a question why the union government has created these new rules, which are considered legally untenable or uncertain. Author says that government wants to send a message to all internet ecosystem players that they have to comply with Indian government's wishes so as to do business in India. Here we should note that government already has significant legal powers in IT Act so as to enforce censorship and surveillance on internet platforms and other web services. This is available with practically no institutionalized oversight or true checks and balances. Why we say the term true? When we say true checks and balances, in such oversight there will be presence of independent members. When there is lack of independent members or absence of independent members in such oversight mechanisms, they are generally called as not true. But in the recent days, there has been increase in public discussion of concerns regarding usage of these powers, and challenges are being made by firms like Twitter. So this is what government is trying to avoid by bringing more stringent rules in a more latent manner. So if there is clear rules and conditions, such firms may not immediately clearly say that there is absence of such rules, etc. The government, while issuing these rules, have made also a reference to increased global interest in the regulation of big tech like in Australia and in European Union. But author says that by increasing government's role and while not bringing any surveillance law reform or in the absence of strong statutory data protection framework, it appears that the interest is more in advancing big government than about big technology. So the article is titled as More About Big Government Than Big Tech. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In this analysis, we primarily saw what do we mean by due diligence obligations in the previous rules notified in 2011. Then we discussed about some concerns in the new set of rules recently released by the government. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This article is with reference to the comments made by Indian Foreign Secretary on India-China trade relations. He said that the current bilateral trade with China is heavily tilted in China's favor and this needs to be reset. So India is simultaneously working on diversifying our sources so as to ensure a more resilient supply chain in the future. The trade details and the trade deficit in favor of China can be better understood from this table. So here in this table, you can find that India's export to China is much, much lesser compared to India's import from China. As a result, there is trade imbalance and we have significant trade deficit, and this is actually the trade deficit that India has with China. Our trade deficit concerns are two-pronged. One is the actual size of the deficit itself, and second is the fact that the imbalance had continuously been widening year after year to reach around 58 billion in the year 2018. In 2019, India's trade deficit with China stood at 56.95 billion, a minor year-on-year decline. And this minor decline was stated as the trade deficit declining for the first time since 2005. See, the growth of trade deficit with China could be attributed to two factors. One is that we export to China a narrow basket of commodities, mostly primary commodities. Then we face significant market access impediments from China, particularly in the context of most of our agricultural products and in the sectors where we are competitive to China. For example, pharmaceuticals, IT and IT-enabled services, etc. And last year, due to COVID-19 and because of associated overall reduction in our bilateral trade deficit with China during the first 9 months saw a reduction of 30.5%. From 42.9 billion to 29.8 billion. In the same period, Indian exports to China increased by 14.9% year on year. These statements are as per the official reports given by Embassy of India in China. Now, this table summarizes the import dependence of India, particularly with China. Among the top 10 countries for import origin, China continues to be the largest import source for India in April to November 2020. While Switzerland does not appear to be in the top 10 import sources, we can find that Germany is the new addition in this list and has accounted for 3.7% share of total imports. Now, this is significant because initially we talked about diversifying our source of imports. So, Germany could be considered in that context. So, these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. We saw the status of India-China trade relation and how imbalance is favoring China, and we also saw the recent developments in this regard, and we also saw the factors to which the growth of trade deficit with China could be attributed. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This article states that ISRO has launched Brazil's Optical Earth Observation Satellite, Amazonia 1, and 18 co-passenger satellites from Satish Dhawan Space Center at Sriharikota. These satellites were carried on board by the launch vehicle PSLV C-51. It is also reported that this is the first dedicated mission of New Space India Limited, which is a commercial arm of ISRO. See, in 2019, Government of India established New Space India Limited as a public sector undertaking under the Department of Space. The purpose was to commercially launch satellites and to become financially self-reliant. In this context, let us discuss in detail about PSLV and GSLV. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this article is highlighted here for your reference. See, when we say launchers or launch vehicles, these are used to carry spacecraft into space. And India has two operational launchers. One is Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, then the other is Geosynchronous Satellite Launch Vehicle. Earlier, that is before PSLV, we had Satellite Launch Vehicle and Augmented Satellite Launch Vehicle. The Satellite Launch Vehicle 3, it was the India's first experimental satellite launch vehicle. It was an all-solid four-stage vehicle capable of placing 40 kilogram class payloads in low Earth orbit. Now, the successful culmination of SLV-3 project, it led to advanced launch vehicle projects like the Augmented Satellite Launch Vehicle, then PSLV and GSLV. See, the ASLV program was designed to increase the payload capacity to 150 kg. You can observe that this is thrice the capacity of that of SLV-3 for low Earth orbits. Now, with a liftoff weight of 40 tons, this ASLV, which is about 24 meter tall, it was configured as a 5-stage all-solid propellant vehicle. Now, have a look at this picture with reference to these launch vehicles. The PSLV is the third generation launch vehicle of India. And it is the first Indian launch vehicle that is to be equipped with liquid stages. So far, we saw that SLV and ASLV, both of them are having solid propellants. PSLV's first successful launch came in the year 1994, and it has emerged as the reliable and versatile workhorse launch vehicle of India. Know that PSLV successfully launched two spacecrafts which are very important. One is Chandrayaan 1 in the year 2008, which went to Moon's orbit. Then Mars Orbiter spacecraft in the year 2013, which went to Mars orbit. And know that PSLV can take up to 1750 kg of payload to sun-synchronous polar orbits of 600 km. Because of unmatched reliability, PSLV has also been used to launch various satellites into geosynchronous and geostationary orbits also. For example, if you take satellites from IRNSS constellation, which refers to Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, some of the satellites are launched through PSLV into geosynchronous and geostationary orbits. Few satellites are launched to sub-geostationary transfer orbits as well. Now coming to the stages in the PSLV launch vehicle, see in the first stage it uses S-139 solid rocket motor, and this is supported by, augmented by 6 solid strap-on boosters. In the second stage it uses earth storable liquid rocket engine called as Vikas engine. The third stage is a solid rocket motor. It provides thrust to the upper stages, particularly after the atmospheric phase of the launch. Then the fourth stage is called as PS4, which is the uppermost stage of PSLV. It comprises of 2 earth storable liquid engines. So in the first stage we saw solid rocket motor with 6 solid strap-on boosters. The second stage we saw liquid rocket engine. The third stage, solid rocket motor. The fourth stage, 2 liquid engines. And with reference to the strap-on motors, there is a fact with reference to PSLV that it uses 6 solid strap-on motors to augment or to increase the thrust provided by the first stage in 2 variants only, that is PSLV-G and PSLV-XL. If you take PSLV CA variant, strap-ons are not used in the core alone version of this variant, that is PSLV CA. Now let's come to GSLV or the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle. Here earlier we had GSLV Mark II, which was the 4th generation launch vehicle having 3 stages, and it had 4 liquid strap-on boosters. In GSLV Mark II, the indigenously developed cryogenic upper stage forms the 3rd stage. The new variant, the next variant of GSLV is called as GSLV Mark III. It has indigenous high thrust cryogenic engine and cryogenic stage, having the capability of launching 4 ton class of communication satellites. So if you see the primary payloads of GSLV, this include INSAT class of communication satellites. They operate from geostationary orbits, and therefore they are placed in geostationary transfer orbits by the GSLV. Now, GSLV's capacity of placing up to 5 tons in low Earth orbits has actually broadened the scope of payloads from heavy satellites to multiple smaller satellites. GSLV has 4 liquid engine strap-on boosters, and the liquid strap-ons augments the thrust achieved in the first stage using a solid rocket motor. And in the second stage, a liquid engine is used called as Vikas engine, and the third stage is the cryogenic upper stage. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article states that the state government of Odisha has started evicting illegal prawn enclosures in Chilika Lake. This move is expected to improve the ecological health of Chilika, which is the Asia's largest brackish water lagoon. In this context, let us discuss in detail about this lake. See, it is a brackish water lake and also a shallow lagoon that is estuarine in character. It is spread across the districts of Puri, Khurda and Ganjam districts in the state of Odisha, and it is fed by around 52 rivers and rivulets. Most prominent among them, we can say Daya, Bargabi and Luna. See, numerous islands are present in this lagoon. Some of them are Kalijai, Honeymoon, Barracuda, Birds Islands, etc. And this lagoon has been designated as a Ramsar site, as a wetland of international importance, since the year 1981. One of the island within this lake is notified as a bird sanctuary under the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. This island is called as Nalaban Island. See, many of the islands in this lagoon are inhabited by large human population, and they depend on this wetland for their sustenance. Around 70% of this population depends on fishing as the means of livelihood. And as we know, this lagoon is also a hotspot of rich biodiversity. It is very rich in both invertebrate and vertebrate fauna. And this Ramsar site is also the habitat for largest congregation of waterfowl in our country. Know that more than 10 lakh birds congregate in this water body for feeding and roosting. Birds belonging to more than 230 species, including 14 birds of prey, can be seen in this lake. Very importantly, this lake is an assemblage of marine, brackish and freshwater ecosystem supporting amazing biodiversity. This is a very important point, as India claims this point with reference to Chilika Lake so as to announce it as World Heritage Site. This point is actually criterion 10 among the 10 criteria so that a particular site can be announced as World Heritage Site by the UNESCO. Right now it is in the tentative list. And as we know, a tentative list is an inventory of those properties which each state party intends to consider for nomination as a World Heritage Site under the UNESCO. And very importantly, this lake is also home to highly endangered Irrawaddy dolphin. This dolphin is threatened due to intensive fishing and plying of mechanized boats in this lake. At present, there are about some 80 to 90 Irrawaddy dolphins in this entire lake. And a small population of bottlenose dolphin also migrate from the sea into the lagoon. Then Rishikulya Beach is a mass nesting beach or rookery along this Chilika coast. Lakhs of olive ridley turtles come here for mass nesting, a phenomenon called as Aribada. Now coming to threats faced by this Chilika lake, we can say siltation, eutrophication, change in salinity regime, then proliferation of freshwater weed, then increased aquaculture activities, changes in species composition, depletion of bioresources, and also decrease in fresh population. Importantly, people have been using migratory birds which come to Chilika for wintering as a source of protein supplement. And over a period of time, it is also claimed that the source of protein supplement has also become a source of livelihood for them. So these are some of the threats faced by this particular brackish water lake. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article talks about the contribution made by CSIR lab in developing a key molecule for Covaxin, which is an indigenous drug designed to fight COVID. In this light, let us see some important details related to the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. See, it is a contemporary pan-India research and development organization. It was set up in the year 1942, before Indian independence. It functions as an autonomous body under the Societies Registration Act of 1860. It is funded by Union Ministry of Science and Technology. Very importantly, note that the Prime Minister of India serves as the President of CSIR and the Union Ministry of Science and Tech is serving as its Vice President. In addition to this, the governing body of CSIR will be guided by a Director General. And CSIR covers a wide spectrum of science and tech, from radio and space physics, oceanography, to mining, aeronautics, and to information technology. It also provides significant technological intervention in many areas with regard to societal efforts. These include environment, health, drinking water, food, housing, energy, farm, and also in non-farm sectors. It has a network of 38 national laboratories, 39 outreach centers, 3 innovation complexes. Know that CSIR is among foremost scientific and industrial research organizations in the world. The main mission of CSIR, we have to notice, to provide scientific industrial research and development that maximizes economic, environmental, and social benefits for the people of India. Now, coming to the news article about the development of key molecule for Covaxin, it states that Indian Institute of Chemical Technology, which is a lab under CSIR, has played an important role in the development of Covaxin, an indigenous vaccine developed by Bharat Biotech International Limited. It is remarked that by making the process affordable and by developing this molecule in a record time, CSIR has shown its commitment towards Atmanirbhar Bharat or self-reliant India. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. See this question asked in UPSC prelims 2013. 3 statements are given. They are asking, with reference to the usefulness of byproducts of sugar industry, which of the following statements are correct? Statement 1, bagasse can be used as biomass fuel for the generation of energy. This statement is correct. Bagasse refers to the fiber that remains after the extraction of sugar-bearing juice from sugarcane. So you can eliminate option B. Now come to the second statement. Molasses can be used as one of the feedstocks for the production of synthetic chemical fertilizers. The statement is incorrect. See, it is used as feedstock for fertilizers, but for organic fertilizers. So you can eliminate option D also. See the third statement. Molasses can be used for the production of ethanol. The statement is correct. We discussed this during our discussion as well. So the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now this question is with reference to CSIR. 3 statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. Statement 1, it aims to provide scientific industrial research and development that maximizes the economic, environmental and social benefits for the people of India. The statement is correct. Eliminate option B. It primarily receives funding from private bodies or organizations. This is incorrect. It is funded by Union Ministry of Science and Technology. So by knowing that the second statement is incorrect, you can directly arrive at the correct answer, option C, 1 and 3, because all the remaining options say second statement is correct. So come to the third statement, which is correct. Prime Minister of India serves as the President of CSIR. The statement is correct. The correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now see this question with reference to Polar Satellite Launch Vehicles. PSLVs are the first generation launches of India with 4 stages, including liquid stages. Though the second half of statement could be correct, it is the statement becomes incorrect because of the term first generation launches. They are third generation launch vehicles in India. SLV is the first generation. First statement is incorrect. Second statement, third stage of PSLV is equipped with indigenously made cryogenic engine. The statement is incorrect because GSLV Mark 2 and 3 are having cryogenic upper stages, not PSLVs. The third stage in PSLV has a solid rocket motor that provides high thrust in the upper stages after the atmospheric phase of the launch. So both the statements are incorrect. Therefore, neither of the statements are correct. Correct answer is option D. See this description-based question. It is a brackish water lake and a shallow lagoon with estuarine character, mainly fed by rivers Daya, Bhargavi, Luna. It is a Ramsar site, home to highly endangered Irrawaddy dolphin. Description refers to option C, Chilika Lake. See these main questions which are given here for your practice. You may write the answer and post them in the comment section. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment and share this video among your friends and those who are in need of such resources. And subscribe to Shankaraj's Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service exam preparation.